On today's show,
the Bulls are embarrassed by their recent play. Can they regroup in time to still make the playoffs?
Will Russell Westbrook keep up this triple-double pace? And will Philly have the worst 82-game season ever?
And we're all about those sweet, sweet dimes in this week's Top 10.
It's Friday, March 25th. The Starter starts now.
Good evening, Sweet World, and welcome to The Starters. Shout out to everyone joining us live on NBA TV and or a little bit later on YouTube. We're happy to have all of you. I'm J.E. Skeets, and alongside me, as always, that's Tass Mellis.
Be good. It's Friday.
Nice. To his right, it's the international man of mystery, taking it to the max, Lee Ellis.
Friend.
Lele.
Lele. And last, certainly not least, it's Starters blog editor, Trey Kirby.
Hey-o!
Hey-o!
Woo! Live studio audience here today.
Well, I'm here at the internet looking for your best tweets at hashtag the Starters, and we had a funny moment in last night's Blazers-Clippers game as Gerald Henderson stepped to the line, looked at DeAndre Jordan, said, watch this. Watch how it go in, taunting DeAndre Jordan about his free throw shooting. Took his shot and missed it, to which DeAndre replied, oh yeah, I watched.
Yep.
Congratulations, you played yourself. But it brings us to today's question. What's the worst NBA prediction you've ever made? We make a lot of bad ones here, so I'll get us started. Like how I predicted Victor Oladipo would beat Zach LaVine in last year's dunk contest. Or how I predicted Nick Vucevic would be an all-star this year. Or how I said the Orlando Magic would make the playoffs this year. That's over three. I'm not going to pick the Magic anymore, but it's not just me. I asked the guys over here for their co-host's worst predictions, and Tass went with Skeets' classic, Jason Maxeal's going to be an all-star, which, nope.
Oh. Hey, there's still time.
Yeah,
there's
is
still
there?
Still time. Come on,
but,
Jason.
But it was just as bad as what Skeets reminded me of when Lee said that Kevin McHale wasn't in any trouble at all, and then he was fired the very next day. But my favorite comes from Lee, who brought back this incredibly weird Tastradamus prediction, which goes, and I quote, in the future, all food will be consumed in pill form. These pills will be shaped like beans. They will taste like beans. There's still time! But we want to hear your worst NBA predictions. Send them to us at hashtag the starters, and we'll laugh at you a little bit later, because we're all dumb.
Oh, yeah. I mean, look, you can't hit them all out of the park.
Yeah, that's right.
Get those tweets in.
I'm 0 for 0 right
now. Yeah, that's true. It's true. All right, on tonight's show, we've got our worst of the week. We got the top 10 plays of the week, but we start with a little trend or dead end if you're new to the show. Here's how this works. Trey, he's gonna throw at some recent NBA developments, and we're gonna debate whether they'll continue or not. Is it a trend or is it a dead end? Trey, first one.
Yes, our first one. After back-to-back losses to the now 12th place New York Knicks, the Chicago Bulls are a game and a half out of the eighth seed in the Eastern Conference, and I think they might be trying to kill me. Is the Bulls missing the playoffs a trend or is it a dead end?
This is real. The Bulls have gone from a team that many thought could deal with the Cavs
some degree
to missing the playoffs. And I think this is a trend. I think they are missing the postseason. They're outside on the outside looking in. And if you look at it, it's a four-team race to get into two spots between that 7 and 10 seed. The Pacers are in. They've got a carrot cupcake of a schedule. They're definitely in. Skeets' wife just made carrot cupcakes.
Yeah,
Nora, they were delicious.
Yeah, shout out to my wife for making carrot cupcakes.
You don't need to refrigerate them.
They're on the brain. So I think there's three teams for one spot. Pistons, Bulls, and Wizards. And the Bulls have a very, very difficult schedule the rest of the way. 7 of 11 are on the road, and that is tough for them. The 23 most road wins in the league. Everybody else that has less than them are out of the postseason.
Yeah.
I think it's going to be a struggle for them. Even if the Pistons have a really tough schedule, I think they're just looking better than a Bulls team that lost a back-to-back. You mentioned that loss to the Knicks. They lost a head-to-head to the New York Knicks. That doesn't really happen in the NBA where you lose both ends, especially if you're fighting for a playoff spot. Up and down the roster, they do not look good.
Those weren't even close games, really, against the Knicks. Knicks punked them back-to-back games.
You could have actually added Chicago to their own schedule there because they are playing against themselves in a lot of ways.
That's deep.
No, I mean, it is because these two losses really are the ones that could hurt them at the end. They could be tied with Indiana right now and almost in a little bit of a safe zone, but instead they're now battling. And as you mentioned, they've got to go on the road and get it done. But for Fred Hoiberg, there's a lot of change with that lineup. There's a lot of players coming in and out, a lot of injuries, and Pau Gasol plays one night and then not the next. I mean, that's not something that's been unexpected because a guy at his age does often sit out games. But that's a big problem, I think, for Chicago. They can't get a solid rotation in there and get the same guys out every
night. And even when they have some of these guys in there, like Jimmy Butler, I mean, he is a shell of his former self right now after the injury around February 5th. You know, went out with that knee injury, comes back, and his numbers have plummeted. I mean, look, he's the first to admit this. He's now saying, this is a problem. I'm not myself. I can't be as aggressive on either end of the floor. They look to him a lot offensively, and he was huge. He was a star, an all-star at the beginning of the year. But since that injury, the numbers, they're brutal. They really are. He can't attack as much, not getting to the line as much, even in the restricted area. And I think even defensively, not just Jimmy, this team, John Schumann. Schumann stat alert. This team was still a top five. And when you think of the Bulls under the Tom Thibodeau era, you thought of a defensive team. And they kept that. They remained that a little bit under Hoiberg in his first year, up until the end of 2015. Since then, Schumann, over January, February, and March, they've dropped. They were 15th in January defensively. Okay, that's average. Then 19th, and now in March, 24th. So, you know, they're never the most offensive juggernaut team in the league. They had to win a lot of those games, I think, under Tom Thibodeau, defensively.
Yeah.
And when that defense isn't there, or is one of the worst over the last little bit, they're not going to win a lot of games. I can't believe this. I agree with you guys. I don't think they're going to get in.
Yeah, and especially on the offensive end, if they're not doing it defensively, they rely on Jimmy Butler. And Jimmy Butler is such a mentally tough guy. For him to be admitting that things aren't working well is a totally bad sign, especially because they don't have more than one day off in between their games the rest of the year. And Jimmy Butler said, usually to get over my knee struggles or my pain, I would get in the gym, I'd work it out. But he doesn't have time for that. He has to rest in between games. So you look at the schedule, and yeah, there aren't a lot of tough teams on it, but the fact that there are a lot of road teams on it, again, they have the 23rd most road wins in the league. That doesn't equal out to a playoff team. It just
really
doesn't.
Only looks like there's three wins there to me for the Bulls. That ain't gonna cut it.
And those two that we've highlighted, they gotta get. They really do have to. I mean, at least the Pistons won on April 2nd, which they have at home, but in Indiana as well would be big to try and get in there. I think one team right now loving this is the Toronto Raptors. We've talked about this, was it last week or earlier this week, about the Raptors not wanting to meet up with the Chicago Bulls in the first round because they've been owned by them. They haven't beat them since, what was it, late December, December 2013.
Last day
I guess it was, last day of December 2013. They, you know, lost all four, of course, this year. That's a team, especially when you're the Raptors and their franchise and their fan base, they haven't won a playoff series in a long time and have puttered out the last two. They didn't want to see the Bulls. They're praying, I think, that Chicago doesn't get in.
Yeah, but surely looking at the way the Bulls are playing those last two games, the Raptors must be licking their lips a little bit and saying, this is our chance to beat them.
Yeah, but sometimes it is matchups, though.
But Jimmy Butler, I mean, I think part of the reason he's struggling to score and shoot the ball, he's got no elevation on his leg. So, I mean, if you take him out of their offense, that really does limit what other options they have. But
big
if you're
time,
the Raptors, you've got to feel like, no, let's take them now while we can, while they're a wounded animal.
We've talked all season long about the Rockets being one of the most disappointing teams and them struggling. I mean, if the Bulls don't make the playoffs, so you're going to look back at this season and put them right there, I think, with the Rockets in terms of, like, what happened. I mean, injuries came into play, but they shouldn't be this bad. All right, Trey, next one.
Well, Russell Westbrook has triple doubles in three of his last four games. He has been on a tear. He's got 15 on the season, which ties Michael Jordan for third most in the past 30 years and puts him just two behind Magic Johnson for most in that time frame. Is Westbrook's triple-double frequency a trend or a dead end?
It's a trend. Look, you already pointed out that I said Jason Maxill would be an all-star. That was like, what, 8 years ago, 9 years ago? I was wrong about that. I was right in our preseason predictions who would lead the league in triple-doubles. I kept it simple and went with Russell Westbrook, and he's going to do it. No one's going to catch him.
No.
And I would expect him to get a couple more here and challenge Magic Johnson at 17 for the most triple-doubles in the last 30 years in 1 year. I think I definitely think Russ can do it.
He's had four games where he's had 9 rebounds as well. So he actually should have the record if it wasn't just one or two little things could have gone his way. But the thing about him, what I think is great, is he wants the rebounds because then he has the ball in his hands and he can start the offense, he can start the transition. And a lot of guys don't want the rebound as badly as he does. So that's why it is likely he's going to keep these up, because he can get out there and then the fast break starts and then he can get an assist easily out of it.
Royce Young for ESPN covers the Thunder. I thought he had a great line about Westbrook. He says he actually doesn't go after the numbers.
Nah.
The numbers come to him. And I truly do believe that. We've seen guys chase triple-doubles before.
Yeah.
Ricky Davis comes to mind. JaVale McGee, Andre Blatt. I mean, we've seen it from time to time. Now, those are guys not getting a triple-double every night.
Yeah.
I don't think any part of Russell Westbrook is looking up at the box score, going, what do I need, another rebound?
Well, they're 15-0.
I really don't. He just plays so hard every single possession that the numbers truly do come to him.
Yeah. They're 15-0 when he gets a triple-double. So it just shows it does actually help his team win.
Of course he's going to get it. He's not going to slow down.
Yeah.
He doesn't have that gear to gear down. He just keeps gearing up. He's not going to sit on the bench. Everything goes through him.
All right, next one, Trey.
Well, Kevin Durant got his what are those on last night when he debuted the craziest pair of shoes we've seen on a court in a long time, an all-orange Nike KD8 Elite High, wearing them during shoot-around, earning him quite a few zings on the internet. Are KD's sock shoes a trend or a dead end?
Those are a trend.
Oh my God, yeah. I hope not.
So the socks right. are connected to shoes. Big deal. Guys have accessories where they cover every part of their body already. Right?
I mean, if
you didn't know those were sock shoes, shoe socks, whatever you call them.
Yeah.
You'd think those are just long socks that he's wearing. So it's cool.
Tass, yeah. There was a photo going around on the internet last night of these. Here's one of them.
Those just look like socks to me.
I thought this was a Photoshop. I went to bed thinking someone had Photoshopped that last night, and I woke up in the morning and I realized, oh my God, this is real. These are real. Now, he didn't wear them in the game, but eventually he probably will. And yeah, it looks like Big Bird. I'm sorry, it does. And Kevin Durant might have skinnier legs than I do, which is even weirder.
Yeah, Daffy Duck or whoever that is.
That's Daffy, confirmed.
I think it's the orange kicks that might make it a little worse. I hope this isn't a trend. Would you rock these, Lee?
I'll give them a try, yeah. Try anything once.
You know, as long as they're free.
Is the spice of life.
Yeah. Yeah. Hold on, if you had to pay for them, Lee, would you rock these?
You have a go with them then.
No, okay.
I mean, I don't think they're going to kick on it because you'd have to have socks on anyway underneath, wouldn't you? You'd at least have
double
something
socks.
Because otherwise your feet would really smell after the game.
But guys wear ankle sleeves and calf sleeves.
But do you like them?
No.
Okay. That's what I wanted to make sure. All right.
I'm not an NBA player.
They're dope. They're cool. They're going to catch on.
Yeah, of course Trey's going to say like.
Last topic. In the midst of a 7-game losing streak, the Philadelphia 76ers are stuck on 9 wins for the season, which would tie the 72-73 Sixers for the all-time worst record in an 82-game season. Is the Sixers losing out a trend or a dead end?
It's a dead end. Because they only need one win.
Yeah.
And I think they're going to get it against the Pelicans. Pelicans, we know, depleted roster. Davis is out. Gordon's out. Ish Smith came from there as well. Bit of a revenge game. I think that's where they're going to get it.
I think they got a few opportunities. The Bucks, the Knicks, they have plenty at home as well. Mm. The Sixers team is not as bad as those 72-73 Sixers.
Oh, no, they're a good 11 wins, this team. Yeah.
Well, they were an entirely different team when they picked up Ish Smith in December. Yeah. Those first 6-7 weeks of the season,
That team saved them, really.
It saved their season. Yeah. They probably would have won 6 games if it wasn't for Ish Smith.
Yeah, you're right about that, but then again, they've lost 24 of their last 26 now here. They're on another bad slide. Mm-hmm. It's crazy how bad they are. Because really, again, they shouldn't be this bad. The Denver Nuggets, who Emmanuel Mudiay hits the crazy game winner against the Sixers, you feel bad for them. They've won 3 times as many games as the 76ers. That's weird, right? I mean, the Nuggets are a better team, but 3 times better? Than a squad in the East, you should have double-digit wins at this point.
I think Jerry Colangelo is going to change things this summer. They're not going to be as bad going forward.
No, they're looking for free agents. Yeah. This is a different team going into the offseason.
I feel bad for a guy like Nerlens Noel, and you've brought this up before. Mm. I mean, here's a guy, you know, they're 9-63 now. The year before that, last year, 18-64.
Mm-hmm.
And the year before that, when he was out rehabilitating his knee, they picked up 19 wins.
Yeah.
He has, in 3 seasons, been in 46 wins.
Yeah.
46.
And that's the thing, the franchise has mailed it in on him. If I was him, I would not consider re-signing there.
Wow.
I just think that's the problem, the risk you take when when you ask players to be patient because we're going to win at some point. But it's like, well, we don't see that happening.
All that said, we think win number 10 at least.
I think they're going to get it. It out.
A Sixers team will have the worst record in history.
That won't change because they've already got it. Maybe they'll tie it. All right, got to take a break when we come back. The starters are all in on hashtag SagerStrong. That and more when we return.
Now it's time for the worst of the week. This week's recipient is cancer. Cancer, unfortunately, has made its way into the NBA world once again. TNT broadcaster Craig Sager was originally diagnosed with leukemia 2 years ago in April 2014. The veteran sideline reporter was back at work 11 months later, but the return to basketball normalcy was short-lived as leukemia forced him to put down the mic only weeks after the NBA family had welcomed him back. Fortunately, things really turned around for Sager this season. After several months of treatment and a bone marrow transplant from his son, Craig Jr., Craig Sr. was at Media Day in September. He traded barbs with Greg Popovich in December and attended All-Star Weekend in Toronto in February. But in the following weeks, his status took a turn. The leukemia was no longer in remission. In a recent episode of HBO's Real Sports, Sager said his doctor informed him that his condition would typically give a patient only 3 to 6 months to live. Sager later clarified through a Turner Sports press release stating that timeline was for people who weren't receiving treatment and that he is receiving the best treatment in the world. The positive news, Craig plans to continue to fulfill his on-air duties and is scheduled to man the sidelines on March 29th, March 31st, and April 7th. To quote Craig from that HBO interview, "I'm still kicking, still fighting. I haven't won the battle, it's not over yet, but I haven't lost it either. There have been some victories and some setbacks, but I still have to fight it. A lot of work to do. Cancer, your worst of the week," and we know Craig Sager will be fighting.
Damn right.
Fighting, fighting, fighting until he wins this battle.
And look, on Tuesday, I saw Russ Bankston, part of the NBA Twitterverse, NBA blogosphere there. On Tuesday, hashtag SagerStrong. He's encouraging, and NBA Twitter accounts are encouraging for guys to wear their, and women, to wear their boldest, loudest,
be Sager.
Sager-like suits. And I say, you send in your photos to us, hashtag the starters when you hashtag
SagerStrong.
SagerStrong, thank you. And we'll do a little of the best. And nice. We got to get some.
Oh, yeah.
We got to get some jackets. Yeah, Lee?
Up there. Count right, me in.
Absolutely. Yeah.
I don't have to go shopping for mine.
No, you don't. No, you just got to open up the wardrobe. You really do. All right. Lots more still to come on the show. We're going to count down the starters' top 10 plays from the past 7 days. Don't go anywhere. Back with the starters. Yes, there he is. Tastradamus, making the predictions in the past. He's 0-0 apparently still. Still waiting on those beans. But we asked you, what's the worst NBA prediction you've ever made? And you hit us up on Twitter. Trey, you got a few of the best answers.
Yeah, Jason says, sort of believing Joe Dumars when he told us that Darko Milicic was a very solid draft pick. Only trust Lee Ellis on very solid things, I would have to say. Alfredo says, the Clippers would automatically win the third game after losing two to prevent a three-game losing streak. Then they lost three in a row after that. Mike says that Nash, Kobe, and Dwight would steamroll the league and win a championship. You're not the only one that's wrong. At least you didn't put them on a magazine cover. Yeah. And Kevin says, Trey Kirby wouldn't wear loafers, hashtag loafergate. That's going to be my Jason Maxey. I'll never live it down.
Yeah, you're right. Right. All right, keep those tweets coming in. What's most the worst prediction you've ever made? All right. Now let's take a look at the top 10 plays that made us celebrate this week, presented by
Ciroc.
Oh, so smooth, gentlemen. At number 10, Isaiah Thomas with the high scoop the Raptors. That is really smooth.
Oh, yeah.
Whoa!
I mean, he throws it from his sort of from his hip there, and up it goes.
At number 9, game winner from the Clippers on Thursday. 1 second left, perfect inbound to J.J. Redick, who hits the shot. Chris Paul goes through the legs of Mason Plumlee. A perfect shot, a great celebration as well. Chris Paul goes right into the stands for a little love. Yeah, gets some there. And then a nice chest bump for J.J.
Nice.
And number 8, a little defense leading to offense for the Timberwolves. That's Karl Anthony Towns denying the Warriors. Going the other way. Uh-oh, Zach LaVine.
Woo!
I like that this dunk comes against the Warriors because, correct me if I'm wrong, gentlemen, this looks a lot like Latrell Sprewell here.
Oh, yeah. Two hands.
Two hand, got the legs kicking up.
That's number 7. Derek Williams is back.
He's back.
Oh man.
Three-quarter court alley-oop from Jose Calderon.
That's a beautiful pass.
What a finish, dude.
Making it look easy. Wow. Oh, this is a great angle.
Right on.
I don't know. Too early in the shot clock. Great play.
Nice
from
catch.
The Knicks. At number 6, look, I don't know, Russell Westbrook just hates rims.
You know what he's doing here.
Lee, don't do it.
He's rocking that rim.
Oh, boy. Well, another
rim. He's doing it again.
Same game,
Lee.
No.
We're going to do it again.
Yeah, he's going to do it again.
No.
Oh, he really rocks the rim on that one.
Every dunk looks the same, but they still look so spectacular.
I know.
It's true. At number 5, Rondae Hollis-Jefferson made an unexpected return to the lineup this week.
Ooh.
109 days without playing a game of basketball, and he had this cool left-handed dunk.
Mm-hmm.
Frank Kaminsky kind of helped it look cool because he touched him in the hip here.
Yep.
So he got a little more horizontal. Welcome back.
Yeah, for sure. At number 4, Steph Curry just turns Dirk around in the corner. And then, he banked home that 3.
How is that possible?
Yeah.
Well, I saw Jordan do this against the Raptors in the Sky Dome. The game, it didn't count.
It
came
count.
After the buzzer.
In 96.
Oh, my God. Come on. That's not fair.
That's not number 1. We're cheating here at number 3. Okay. 3 gorgeous passes this week. The touch pass from LeBron James to start us off. This is mean. He's got that vision from on top of the key. He makes lots of things happen from there. Steph Curry makes things happen everywhere.
Oh, man.
The left-handed push ahead. Draymond Green didn't have his head up.
He's not even watching.
That's a great catch.
He almost got popped.
Yeah.
And another left-handed push ahead here. D'Angelo Russell, the bounce pass variety this time. This is his strong hand. That was Steph's offhand.
Yeah, he is a lefty, though.
He is a lefty.
Ah, LeBron James at number 2. Nothing cryptic about this dunk.
Oh.
That's just a big dunk. right?
That's all that
there's
is.
There's no hidden message to this.
Kind of feel bad for already using your Ciroc the Rim, don't you?
I know. There was a lot to use it on this week.
Good point.
And at number one, Emmanuel Mudiay's game winner. This was incredible. He lost the ball and tosses it up. 3 seconds left. Underneath their own basket, inbounds, Emmanuel Mudiay loses it, tosses it up from near midcourt.
Oh. March Madness. The Nuggets are going to the Elite Eight!
Wild.
They might play Villanova. Are Villanova still in it? I don't know.
Mudiay never got to play in the NCAA.
They took an L last night.
Yeah, you're right. That is his Cinderella moment. Look, great plays from the NBA. Check out this play from last night's D-League. Wow! DJ Stephens throws down the huge alley-oop here for the Iowa Energy. DJ Stephens, it's like the best Full House name ever. DJ and Stephanie Tanner. Huge dunk. Nice play. All right, one more break. When we come back, Lilies! Very solid play. Won't be as fancy as some of those top 10 plays, I don't think. Back to the starters. Tonight's pick 'em play, it's the Hornets and Pistons. Tass and I have the Pistons at home. Lee and Trey have the Hornets on the road. This is a big game for the month of March when it comes to the pick 'em play. Lee.
It's on NBA TV.
That's right, 7:30 start. Lee, where are we going for a very solid play?
We're heading out to Brooklyn. Now, we have seen this play before, but it's still just as beautiful. Big Brook Lopez just dropping it off here. Watch this. Double bounce pass. Shane Larkin finishes. That's beautiful. That's what I call a very solid play.
That's solid, Lee.
Way to go, Lee. We recorded the hour and a half long drop podcast this morning. It's up on iTunes, Google Play, our website. We tweeted out Facebook. Anyway, we talk and discuss LeBron James, what he's thinking these days. We look at the Sixth Man of the Year nominees, try and make our potential picks for that before we get into the starties, our award show. And we had a great debate about which young trio is more talented, the Minnesota Timberwolves or the Milwaukee Bucks. That was a fun debate. So check out the Drop podcast. Lee, I believe we have time for one fan sign.
A brother and sister combination of Kerry and Kim were Indiana, and they sent us in two signs, really. So very good job. Thanks a lot, guys. Keep them coming. They'll be on Facebook.
All right. Yeah. Get those signs in, hashtag the starters, let us know, and Lee gets them up on Facebook, as he said. All right, that's it for us. Back Monday, 7 p.m. Eastern. Enjoy your weekend. Enjoy your Easter.
All right, thanks for joining us, folks. And remember, this isn't an and remember, this is just personal. Happy Greek Independence Day, everybody.
Yeah, race the weekend, people. Bobble your head, too, man. Yeah, there you go.